As we go to prayer this morning, I want to invite you to hear this passage that comes from Jeremiah 29, verse 7. And then I'm going to lead us in a time of praying for our community. And God wants us to lift up our community. He wants us to be a place where people will meet Jesus. He wants us to be a place where there is prosperity according to the kingdom of God, not according to our world. And I want you to hear what he says in Jeremiah 29, 7. It was a time when God's people were in exile, forced to live in another land. They never knew when they would go home. And the Lord says these words to them, Seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have carried you in exile. Pray to the Lord for your city, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. God calls us to pray his blessing upon our cities. And so we want to do that this morning as we lift up our community and as we seek to be an agent of change, an agent of hope, and an agent of the light of Jesus Christ. Will you pray with me? Our Father, this morning as we gather, we thank you for the cities that surround us. We thank you and pray this morning for the city of Chino, for the city of Chino Hills. We pray for Eastvale. We pray for Ontario. Father, we pray for Rancho Cucamonga. We pray for Corona. We pray for Norco. Father, we lift up all of these cities this morning, and we pray that in the powerful name of Jesus, you would use us as individuals and as a church to be light in the darkness of these places. Father, that we would speak against injustice where we see injustice, that we would share the good news of Jesus on the fields and in the neighborhoods, in the schools, in the malls, in the parking lots of the cities that you have called us to bear witness. We pray that you would give us wisdom as a church to know how to minister to our communities in ways that will be profound and will make a kingdom difference. We pray that we would not look away from poverty, that we would not look away from injustice, but Father, that we would, with courage and the power of the Holy Spirit, speak into these places, walk into these places, and minister in the name and the power of Jesus Christ. We pray for those who have been called to places of leadership in city government. We pray that you would give them wisdom. We pray for the businesses in our communities. We pray that you would bless them, that they would prosper for the sake of our communities. We pray this morning for those who are teaching, for those who are in places of responsibility for education. And we pray, Lord, that the level of education in our community would just continue to rise to give hope to a new generation. We pray that we would be a community that would be known for the protection of its children, that we would be a community that would be known for the protection of its unborn, that we would be a community that would be known as a place of light, even if the world does not understand it. Father, we pray that you would bless the churches in our community, that, Lord, there would be revival in every church in our community, that there would be renewal, that there would be passion for Jesus, passion for the gospel, passion for biblical truth. We pray, Lord, that you would bless our community. We would also pray this morning, Lord, for Babe Buma, Lord, we pray that, Father, that you would bring your healing hand upon her. Give her strength and encouragement today. We pray for Steve Dalma and his family and the loss of his father. Lord, we pray for comfort. We pray for eternal perspective. We pray for strength. We pray for all of those who are here today who are hurting and in need of your healing touch this morning. We ask that you would bless. We ask that you would encourage. We ask that you would inspire. We ask, Lord, that you would step into the circumstances of our lives in a way, Lord, that will bring transformation. For we ask this and pray all of this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, I want to share with you something that was, it was a special report on This American Life. And here's what they were talking about. They were saying that rarely does anybody growing up as a child end up doing plan A in their life. What they were saying was, we all have dreams and ambitions as we grow up, but rarely do we end up doing what we call plan A. Plan A being that plan that we had when we were a child. You remember, right, some of the dreams that you had as a child? I remember at one point, I was convinced that I was going to be a doctor. And then that was plan A. Well, I realized that I wasn't very good at chemistry. So then I went to the next plan, and I was going to be a speech therapist. And I'd been accepted to UC Santa Barbara, and I was going to be a speech and hearing therapist. And then in this, my last semester before I was going to go off to UC Santa Barbara, I took an accounting class. And I realized I loved accounting. So now plan C was I was going to be an accountant. Little did I know that God had a different plan for me. And maybe your story is very similar. Well, they had 100 people in the audience that day on This American Life, and they said, how many of you are still doing plan A in your life? Out of 100 people, only one person raised their hand. She was 23 years old. Here's what I want you to see this morning. The gospel, the coming of Jesus Christ, his death on the cross is not plan B, was not plan C, was not plan D, it was plan A from the beginning of time. God knew from the beginning of time that he would be sending his son into the world to live the perfect life that we could not live, to take our place on the cross so that indeed the promise of God that we see throughout the Old Testament, that he would be our God and we would be his people, would finally be fulfilled in the life and the death of Jesus. It's not plan B. It's not plan C. It's plan A. It was God's plan before he created the world. And that's what we see throughout the Bible. Well, this morning, what we're going to look at as we continue our journey through the book of Ephesians, and this morning as we prepare our hearts for communion, what we're going to see today is this incredible reality. We're going to see God's extraordinary plan. And Paul gets so excited about it. And his passion should be our passion as well. Paul was committed to sharing this extraordinary plan because his life had been turned upside down by this extraordinary plan. It had changed his life. And he was no longer living plan A in his life, but because he received God's plan A, he now became an apostle for Jesus Christ. And he was willing to give his life for that. If you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3, and we're going to be reading verses 1 to 13. And as I read this, I want you just to receive this. I want you to think deeply about what it is that Paul is writing. I want you to think about what he's saying about the extraordinary plan of God. And as you hear this, then we're going to talk a little bit about it. And it's my hope this morning that you will fall even more in love with God's plan, his extraordinary plan. And I hope you'll come to a deeper understanding. I hope that if there are some of you who have never said yes to this plan, that you will say yes to it this morning. For some maybe who have grown kind of cold to the gospel, you feel at a distance from God. I hope as you confront or are confronted by this extraordinary plan and the incredible love of God for you, that you will say, oh Lord, I renew my love for you today. So let's hear what God says. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. See, Paul loved God so much that he was willing to be a prisoner for the plan of God. Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. Paul writes, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given to me, here it is, to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ, and to make plain to every person the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. His intent was that now, through the church, through Crosspoint, through all the churches, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him, through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are for your glory. Will you pray with me? Our Father, we thank you for the power of the gospel, for the power of this word this morning. And Father, we ask that as we allow you to minister to us through your truth, that you would encourage and inspire us, Lord, to see your truth, and not just to see it, but to see how you want to connect this truth with our lives in order to transform us. And we thank you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I want you to see some incredible things this morning about the extraordinary plan of God, because God wants to light a fire under each and every one of us, to use the gifts that he has given to us in order that we might be encouraged and inspired as his disciples to change the world for his sake. Here's the first thing I want you to see. The gospel, which literally means good news. What is the good news? The good news is that God sent his son into the world, that he lived a life of perfect obedience to the commands of God, unlike any other person who has ever lived. And so he became the perfect sacrifice for our sins in order that we might be forgiven, in order that we might have life now and forevermore. The gospel is God's plan from the very beginning of creation. This was God's plan. Listen to what we read in verse 6. This mystery is that through the gospel, this good news of Jesus, the Gentiles, that means non-Jews, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together in the promise of Christ Jesus. Now what I want to do is I want to break this down, this one verse down just a little bit before we move on. Here's what I want you to see. Number one, the gospel, this good news of Jesus Christ, is God's plan for the world. I think a lot of Christians get confused, and they think that God is constantly adjusting to what happens in the world as if he never sees it coming. That God is constantly trying to adjust to the things that are happening in the world, and he's just trying to hold everything together. No. God, at the very beginning of time, looked forward. He saw all of history in one moment. He created Adam and Eve, and he knew what they would choose. And we see even elements of the gospel, even in Genesis chapter 3. We see elements of the gospel even in Genesis chapter 2. God knew from the beginning of time that he would be sending his son to die on the cross for us. The gospel is God's plan for the world. Listen to what he says. This mystery is that through the gospel. This mystery. This word mystery is a great word. It's a word that was common in the Roman Empire. It was a word that was used often in the worship of false gods. It was the word that was used often in the worship of the false god of Ephesus, which was Artemis. Mystery, mysterion. And what Paul is saying, yes, we have a mystery as well that has now been revealed through Jesus Christ. And it's a mystery as he connects with their false religions. He makes it clear that Jesus Christ is the mystery that all of these people seeking false gods are trying to find. Friends, I believe this. We will never be whole until we are whole in Christ. We will never be fulfilled until we are filled by Christ. And I believe that is true for every human being. Every time I meet somebody who doesn't know Jesus, I know this. There is a hole in their life that only faith in Jesus Christ can fill, because that's the way that God made them. The gospel is the only thing that can satisfy. The gospel is the only thing that can meet the needs of their lives that they think are going to be met in money, in possessions, in human relationships, in worshiping whatever it is that they worship in this world. I know that this is true. Jesus Christ is the mystery of God. And he is the only one who satisfies. That's why I am open to sharing the gospel, because I know every human being needs this. We read on and we see that the Gentiles together are heirs with Israel. Now, this was unheard of, and we talked a little bit about it last week, but the Jews believed that God was just for them. God never intended just to be for the Jews. They were simply a prepared people to receive his son for the sake of the world. That's why Israel was called. That's why God created Israel. Is that through all the things that they did, all their religious regulations, all pointed to Jesus. At some point, I'll do a whole series where we see the whole Bible points to Christ. The Gentiles, you and I who aren't Jews, are heirs together. What does it mean to be an heir? It means that you're someone who is receiving an inheritance. An heir is somebody who receives an inheritance. When I said yes to Jesus, I became part of the family of God, an heir of all the promises made by God. So it says, I am a sharer together in the promises of Jesus Christ. What are those promises? I want you to hear some of the promises, and I want you to lay your life against it and ask yourself, is this my story? It's the promise of joy. Jesus promised us joy, John 15. It's the promise of peace, John 14. It's the promise of eternal life, defined in John 17 as knowing God and the Son whom he sent, knowing by experience, knowing by encounter. Being filled with the Holy Spirit. We see in John 14, it's the promise that we would receive the very Spirit of God within our lives to live with us in such a way that God would never leave us as an orphan. He would never forsake us. We would be His forever children. And the promises go on and on and on. And here's what I know. I am an heir through faith in Jesus Christ to the promises that He made. I think that's pretty incredible. And it goes on, and we saw last week that because of what Christ did, there's no longer a dividing wall of hostility between God's people, but we are unified. We are one, for we are together in one body. Every race, every language, every personality. We are heirs together, shares one body. We go on and we see what the plan of God reveals. Let me share with you this plan of God. What does it reveal to us about what is true? What I want to do in this section is to share with you, as we look at this plan of God through this passage, what does it reveal to us about God? What does it reveal to us about how we connect with His plan? And I want you to think deeply about these truths, because each one of these truths can change the trajectory of your life. Listen to what he says. The plan reveals that God is sovereign over all of history. What does it mean that he's sovereign? It means that he's in control of all of history. Nothing happens apart from his awareness and power. God can change anything. Now, for some of you, that creates consternation and struggle, because I think most of us sit back and say, God, why? Why, God, why? I mentioned last week that a great man of God, Nabil Qureshi, only 34 years old, died of stomach cancer, an incredible man of God who had, from my human perspective, was going to make this incredible impact in the world. Why, God, why? Was God a victim of what was happening? His hands up in the air, I can do nothing about it? Of course not. God is sovereign over all things. And that's what we read here. He says, in reading this, then you will be able to understand my insight, Paul says, into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to men in other generations, as now it has been revealed to the godly prophets and apostles. Now, this is an amazing reality. You and I live on this side of the cross. The people in the Old Testament would ultimately be saved by what Christ would do on the cross by their faith in the plan of God that they could not fully grasp nor fully understand. God had given pieces of it, and now as we look back, we see it all come together as one story, as one plan, and it's beyond brilliant. It's phenomenal. And again, at some point, I will share with you the unity of the entire story of God, how the Old Testament was all about pointing us and preparing us for Jesus. But they couldn't see that before Christ was born fully. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles, again, the good news of what Jesus did for us and dying for us on the cross, this mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members of one body, sharers together in the promise in Jesus Christ, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. God in the Old Testament, He had a plan. His plan was to prepare Israel so that they would be ready to receive His Son. It was a prepared community. And everything that happened in history is pointing toward that. God is not a victim, friends. And I've got to tell you how comforting it is to me in my life to know this. There are things I can't explain. There are things, as I've said before, that I would do differently. And it's a good thing that I'm not God. And one day when we stand before Him, we will know and we will see clearly. Friends, I do not make light of the fact that some of you have suffered horrible things in your life. And to hear that God is sovereign over all things is hard. But we chose sin. And sin entered the world. And God, by his grace and goodness, allows us to suffer the consequences of not only our choices, but the choices of others. But he is still sovereign over that. Don't ever let anybody tell you that God is not in control. That is our comfort. That is our hope. It's a core belief of the Christian faith. It's a core belief of the Reformation. The next thing I want you to see is that God's passion is that you and I and all people would have a relationship with him. God wants to have a relationship with you. I believe when I receive communion, I often think this thought: if I was the only person God ever created, Jesus would have come and died for me. He loves me that much. God knew me and he knew you before he made us. Before the creation of the world, he knew you. He loved you. And he sent his son for you. For you. For you. He knows your name. You matter to him. You may feel all alone in this world, but you are not all alone. God knows you and he loves you. He's passionate about you. We read this in Christ and through faith in Christ. See, we have faith in Christ, so now we live in Christ. And what happens in that reality? We now may approach God with freedom and confidence. Friends, this side of the cross, that was unheard of. You didn't just enter into the presence of a holy God. You would be consumed. You're a sinner. There was, in the holy temple in Jerusalem, there was a room called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. And it was a room that had this huge curtain that surrounded it. It was a very small room. It was a very thick curtain. One time a year, on the Day of Atonement, the chief priest would enter that room. For many years, it had the Ark of the Covenant until it was lost. And the chief priest would enter that room and offer sacrifices for the sake of the people. Church history records, not the Bible, but church history records, they would tie a rope to the priest's ankle so if he was consumed by the holiness of God, they could pull his body out. You couldn't go into the presence of God. You and I couldn't go into his presence. He was holy and we are sinful people. But the moment that Jesus died on the cross, according to the Gospel of Matthew, the curtain that surrounded the Holy of Holies was torn from top to bottom. It was so tall and so thick, only God could do it. Why did he do that? Because now we may enter with confidence into the presence of God. By the blood of Jesus, we have been made holy, so now we can enter the presence of God. We can come before him with confidence. We can approach him with freedom. No more fear, no more shame, no more hiding, no more running. Is that amazing? It is one of the greatest truths in all of reality. I don't need to run. What did Adam and Eve do when God, after they had sinned? They ran and they hid from God. We don't need to run anymore. Jesus restored us. And now we may have a relationship with the living God where we may now commune and fellowship with God through faith in Jesus Christ and in Christ. What an amazing reality. We go on and we see that God gives us grace to serve him. Now, when we think of grace, we think of nice little things that make life more fun for us. And when I think of grace is like a gift. Grace, think of grace this way. Grace is receiving a gift that you haven't earned and you don't deserve. That's what grace is. God gives grace because he's a gracious God. And he extends grace to his people, you and me. Now, when I think of gifts from God, I think, God, give me peace, give me joy, give me long life, give me kids that obey me. Are you taking notes, honey? But did you know that a grace that God gives to us is the ability to serve him? Have you ever thought about serving God as a gift from God? You see, so many Christians don't serve because it takes time and it takes energy and it takes effort, and sometimes it's hard to do depending on what God's asked us to do. And if you're not doing that, you are missing a grace that God wants to give to you. Listen to what Paul says. Surely you've heard about the administration of God's grace that was given for me. What was the administration of God's grace? It was the gift of apostleship. It was the gift of preaching and planting churches. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Paul says, what I've done because of God's grace. What I've done in serving you, I've done because of God's grace. Paul loved it. Now, what did it mean for Paul? Beatings, whippings, prison, and lastly, beheading. But when you serve God, you find that it is a grace. I would do nothing different with my life. And Beth hates it when I say this, but I would do this for free. Now, I didn't tell the council that when I was, before I came. I would. Because serving God is a grace, it's a gift. Paul, when he writes these words, he's in a prison cell. He's been there for 3 to 4 years, chained probably to a guard. And he says, oh God, thank you for the grace you gave to me to serve. He goes on, he says, although I'm less than the least of all of the Lord's people, and the more you grow in Christ, the more you realize that's true, this grace was given to me, here's the grace, to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ, to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which is Christ, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. I mean, you just get caught up in Paul's excitement about getting to suffer for Christ. Because we go on and we see that God even uses suffering to accomplish this incredible plan of his. His plan is administrated through God's people who use the gifts he's given them to serve him. God even uses our suffering to accomplish his purposes. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles, I ask, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings, which for you are for your glory. Paul spent time in prison. We probably would not have much of the New Testament today if Paul had not been in prison. It was because Paul was in prison and could not go out and preach the gospel outside of his prison. It was because he could not visit the churches that Paul in prison wrote the very letters that have become much of the New Testament today. I call that an extraordinary plan of God. See, the world looks at that and says, what a tragedy, what a terrible thing. Paul could not fully grasp at that moment that his letters that he was sending, he's writing to this church in Ephesus, would be something we would be reading and studying 2,000 years later. But God knew, and it was part of his extraordinary plan. There are things that happen to us in our life that we don't understand, that are a challenge, and we don't get it. But this I know, God can take the worst things and worst circumstances of our lives, and he can build something beautiful out of it, and only God can do that. Because God has an extraordinary plan, And God is in control of all of history. He is sovereign. And friends, I can't tell you how many times that brings hope. And often we will not see the parts of that plan that were lived out until we go to be with Jesus one day. And so we trust him by faith. And we walk by faith, continuing to love him in the midst of hardship, not fully grasping, not fully understanding, but believing that God can take this, any circumstance, and do something beautiful out of it. Read Romans 8:28. And then God's plan for the church is to proclaim the gospel to heaven and earth. Church, this is God's will for us. We are the voice of God in this world. We are the ones called to proclaim the gospel, to live out the gospel in the relationships that God has given to us. I don't believe that there are any chance relationships. I believe that God calls me and puts people in my life because he uniquely has prepared me to minister to them. There are people you will reach I could never reach because of my personality and because I don't have a relationship with them. But you are uniquely equipped to reach them. And God has placed them in your path. They're in your neighborhood. They're in your workplace. They're in your school. They're in your family. And God has uniquely prepared you to be the one who carries the mystery of God, who is Jesus Christ, the gospel, to them. Friends, I've been thinking a lot about this. I've been thinking a lot about this week. And I want you to hear, and I just wrote this down. Who are the people who don't know Jesus that God has already placed in your life? Are you praying for them? Start today. Make a list of 4 or 5 or 6. Make a list and begin to pray for them. And if you don't have non-Christians in your life because all of your friends are Christians, get out there. And let's share Jesus. Let's build relationships with integrity because we sincerely love people. They're not a notch. We're not doing that just to share the gospel. We're doing that because God wants to love them through us. Are you looking for opportunities to tell them about Jesus? Are you inviting them to church? Invite them to church. I'll guarantee you they will hear the gospel here. Invite them to church. And let's be a church that makes sure that everybody who comes through this door, regardless of their life, is loved, has a place, that there are people reaching out to them. I had somebody share with me just this morning that they had been at a church one time, and they sat in the church and around people, and all these people knew each other. In the time of greeting, all the people who knew each other just gravitated together, and they were standing there, visitors, all alone. I pray that never happens in this place because it makes a difference. We are not only to speak the gospel, we are to live out the gospel. And at the very foundation of the gospel is God's love for people. Bring them, invite them. Are you serving them? Are you modeling Jesus for them? Friends, this week, I heard a story that really, really challenged me. It was a pastor who was sharing the story. I was at a gathering with other pastors, and this particular pastor actually does a lot of consulting, a lot of traveling, and he rides Uber a lot. And he was talking about how Uber has now become his place, one of his primary places for sharing the gospel. And he shared a story of something that just had happened a couple weeks ago. He was in the car with this man, and they started talking. And the driver was from the Middle East, and he wasn't a committed Muslim, but that was his background. And the man asked the pastor what he did for a living. Whoop, there goes the door, right? He said, well, I'm a pastor. for Jesus. And the man, with great intensity, made eye contact with him. And he said, you know, I began reading the Bible. I read from Genesis all the way to Matthew 10. And then in Matthew 10, I stopped. Because the church isn't doing this, so they must not believe it's important. Here's Matthew 10. Jesus sent out his disciples. It's kind of a dry run. He said, go out and tell them about me. He said, I don't see anybody doing that. And if Christians really believed what they claim to believe, why would they be silent? Oof. Well, by the end of the Uber ride, they had pulled over, and this man gave his life to Jesus. Friends, you don't have to do it perfectly. Just tell them your story. Tell them what Jesus has done for you. Invite them to church. And it doesn't have to be Cross Point, any Bible-believing church. Let's reach our community, amen? Amen. Let's reach our world, amen? Amen? God has created you and placed you for such a time as this. Let us be a church that is faithful. Would you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the power of the gospel. Lord, I just confess to you, I know that I miss so many opportunities because I'm tired, because I'm shy, because I'm reserved in the moment, because I just don't want to get involved. Forgive me. Lord, I pray that we would be as a church a light, another light in this community, for there are so many wonderful churches. But Lord, there are so many people in this community, in the reach of our church, that don't know you. May we be those who use the gifts that we've been given to serve you faithfully, that the gospel of Jesus Christ would ring out boldly in our neighborhoods, in our schools, in our workplaces, in our community. May we see many come to faith. For we ask this in Christ's name. Amen.